production still critical acclaim in Europe and America. Aleksey directed over 30 productions in New York alone, his latest being his take on Dostoevsky's Crime and Punishment, which played to rave reviews and enjoyed many sold-out performances at the West End Theater. He's a recipient of numerous awards. I will not list all of them. Please check online if you're interested. And he's not only a director, he's also a teacher. He taught in St. Petersburg, in Denmark, here in New York, he's still teaching. And he also taught at Ankara, Turkey, in Mexico, and most recently in Osaka and Tokyo, Japan, where he taught at Theater Communications Laboratory. The title of this lecture and presentation is The Golden Age, Anton Chekhov and the Moscow Art Theater. So please welcome Aleksey Burago.
And sorry to be late, it's just unexpected. Rains, just great. Taxista. So, I don't know how, you didn't say anything, yeah?
I said some basic things.
Okay, so how to start? Too many things to talk about Chekhov, because I would say for all Russian people, Chekhov is like, at least for Russian speaking population, Chekhov could be considered like a relative, yeah? I would say like for the most famous, probably, analogy could be used like the Mononcle, yeah?
Do you
want to
see
it? Let's take a look at it.
Ready? Let's start. 15.
Definitely, like it's not Mononcle. It is Monsieur Pilot's Holiday, but I believe Jacques Tati humility. Jacques Tati, I would say, sense of humor. Jacques Tati, modesty. Whatever we can find things to describe. To describe Jacques Tati, probably we can say the same about Chekhov. Even if it is like I would say 60 years difference between work of these beautiful artists. Yeah? So, okay, no, here, where do you go? Where do you go? Why I decided to use Jacques Tati to start talking about Chekhov? Because I think it's the most important, in my opinion, the most important quality of Chekhov's work is sense of humor. So without without paying attention to Chekhov's sense of humor, I think it will be no Chekhov. No Chekhov. Why? No. Let's say Chekhov start to write as a humorous writer. So he start writing short stories, anecdotes, and pages of numerous newspapers, and he's like a funny, you see, very many funny nicknames. Antosha, brother of my brother, sigil number 6, sigil number 9, Kislyaev, it means sour tasted, Shampansky, Antosha Chiganter. He used like plenty, many, I think it's about 50 different nicknames before he started using his own name. And I would say most of his plays are comedies. Even he, Sigil is comedy, yeah. Cheryochet is a farce. One can say Uncle Vanya, it is scenes from country style. But if you start reading like his letters or his memoirs about him, he was trying to write three sisters he named vaudeville. So Cherry Orchard is a farce. He talked about them by himself. So Sigil is a comedy. So but I don't know, if you start reading probably most of his plays, you can see that it is melancholy, depressing. Tone of the words leads you to melancholy and depression. But if you start analyzing it by events, you will find very funny structure. Very funny structure. So how to say so? Of course, we all know that Chekhov debut as a playwright was a disaster. And it's in Imperial Theater, he wrote Sigil in 1995. And it went through like very numerous censorships, and it was allowed to be performed in Aleksey Theater. As I know, it was only 7 rehearsals. 3 of them were canceled because Maria Gavrilovna Savina, the star of the show who was playing Arkadyevna, she decided not to play. So, Mr. Zhevsky, who was maybe the best Nina Chekhov considered, whatever he was seen in his of his own productions, he liked Komisarevsky the most. So she stayed, but still, it was 7 rehearsals. Director was mostly, his name was Karpov, nobody knows about him these days. And definitely, it's not about talent. Maybe he was talented, we don't know. But by that time, it was hard to say because how to direct Davidov, Savin, it's not possible, I would say, especially in this structure of the theater. So, seven rehearsals compared to Stanislavski, 190, it is a difference, yeah? 190 rehearsals and oh, seven. Even not seven, like it was four rehearsals, even not full rehearsals. So they study the lines, they learn their lines, and then they perform it as they feel. So, no, but if you'll start paying attention to what Chekhov trying to do with the theater, because we still consider him as a playwright, especially outside of Russia, yeah? Because in Russia we know there's a, like, it's a prestige to have a full edition of Chekhov on your shelf. And everybody tried, because some people buy it, because it looks great, and people put it on, they never open it, but they give it on the shelves. So, but for Russian people, you have to read short stories. You have to read Ванька, it's mandatory for most of us. You have to read. So when I came here, and I was surprised, Chekhov mostly known as a playwright. And playwright of depression, playwright of boring, like disastrous circumstances. And I was surprised because I don't know this Chekhov. I know Chekhov's sense of humor. I know Chekhov, everybody talks about him. He was joking all the time, even he was dying. He joked. He just asked for champagne. And even champagne was a poison in his condition, because it creates CO2, yeah, and it is, and in its last stage of tuberculosis, it is poison. So he killed himself, maybe a few hours before natural cause. So but when he was still, but he was not in great health. All his life, he got sick when he was 18. He was this tall. He was full of life, full of health. Everybody who met him found him like just pinky cheeks, beautiful charming smile, and he was healthy, healthy looks. Of course, tuberculosis was incurable disease by that time. So his brother died. So it was probably in the family, in the genes. whatever you read about him, especially what people talk when people talk about him, and you read his letters to many people, it's all published. Which is this is what is beautiful about it. Everything is about Chekhov is published. If you want to know what Chekhov meant, just read it. Because I was very much surprised when I came here. People read one play, and they instead doing the play, without reading short stories, other plays, letters, notebooks. Because, of course, Chekhov made revolutionary theater. I will explain what does it mean. So before Chekhov, structure of the theater was based on ancient Greek structure. So it is a protagonist, antagonist, yeah, and crowd, and
chorus around
protagonist, antagonist. Shakespeare didn't change the structure. Yeah? Shakespeare took a few people from chorus, and gave them life. What did Chekhov? He eliminated structure, protagonist, antagonist. He create ensemble. So the protagonist is a group of people. Ensemble is a protagonist. Yeah, I could prove it because it's many references to that. So this require a new kind of training. You cannot. So why every time I go to see Broadway production, we start, nothing's coming together because it's stars. If you will put stars to play soccer, they will lose to many teams that they structured as a team. They will lose. It was proved many times. So So it was, it's not star-oriented plays, it is a company-oriented play. So it's ensemble that, it is a, how to say, it's a family. It has to be family. Many directors, including, we were planning to use them. Of course, it's not only Russians. Like, first, the person who said about it, Aleksey Dmitrievich Popov, he said Chekhov is not possible to do without family. So it is an imperative that you build family of actors that could deliver the meaning of the play. One person is not enough. One star, even huge star, cannot do the play. So then we can see Peter Stein productions also. But the most important is George Australia. We will come to that a little later, yeah? George Australia, Piccolo Theater, Cherry Orchard, one of the best, probably, production on Czech. So, no, let's start from the beginning, like, because when Chekhov started writing plays, first of all, he said, I'm fascinating vaudeville ideas. It means I could do vaudeville ideas, few ideas every day. He was found in vaudeville. It was, he considered his, it is like his talent. So it happened this way that he was friends with Levitan, Korovin, Serov. It is the most wonderful, yeah, let's take a look, wonderful impressionist of Russian culture. It's very unique. It's not nothing like French impressionism or American impressionism. It's very beautiful, unique, nostalgic. It's beautiful impressionistic art. So he was sitting. He was sitting in a Korovin. Korovin has memoirs. Yeah, look, it's beautiful. So. Korovin, he was sitting in Korovin study and watching him painting, and he was saying, this kind of theater I want to create, this kind of theater I want to do, this is kind of, yeah, but we know impressionism from Manet, we know from Seurat, we know, of course, Russian impressionist, it has a certain kind of color of Russia, like depression color. But I would say, Chekhov very much, it is between two polarities. You have to say, his heroes very often make choices between to drink tea or to kill myself. Yeah? So it's a kind of, you can see it here too. Okay, it's still Levitan. Levitan. He was a friend of the family of Chekhov's. He proposed to his sister Maria Pavlovna Chekhov, and Chekhov said, "Don't marry him," because he was a crazy man. Actually. And I think something about what he it, once Chekhov came to, He called Chekhov and said, I need you because I want to commit suicide. So Chekhov came and found Levitan coming from the lake with this bandage around him, like a black bandage around, black, because he was very handsome, and black went very well with his looks. So he came to see Chekhov with a seagull. He killed a seagull and he was carrying this seagull. He was a strange man. It was before Siegel, actually.
This is self-portrait.
This is self-portrait. No, of course, this doesn't translate the charm of the person.
This is
Korovin. Yeah. The reason that Levitan tried to kill himself because he was in love affair with two different, with one married woman, another with two married women. And because he didn't know how to negotiate it, so he decided the easiest way to try to kill people. what he missed. So it's already a comical effect in a play. So so it 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 uh, uh, No, I don't know how to prove, like, but whatever I could say, it is Korovin, yeah? Yeah, Korovin, yeah. It's a lot of similarities between Korovin, Levit, and Serov. Serov, it's also Korovin, yeah. So, you understand where we're going, yeah? Because it's still impressions. Impressions was kind of main word in Chekhov vocabulary in terms of the theater. So, Nemirovich Danchenko, who directed Three Sisters in 1940, and it was the most probably famous production in Russian theater of Moscow Art Theater, organized. Yeah, this is Nemirovich Danchenko. Yeah, yeah. Let's talk a little bit about that, because you know, it is Stanislavski, Nemirovich Danchenko, so they're founders of Moscow Art Theater. So Nemirovich Danchenko read play Siegel before it was produced in Alexandrinka Theater. He gave feedback to Chekhov, said he's a wonderful play. And the day, the year Siegel was published, Nemirovich Danchenko wrote play Our Days, who nobody knows about these days, but he got Griboyedov's prize for that. But nobody cares for his play, sorry. He's a famous director, wonderful, intelligent man. And he wanted to give this prize to Chekhov, but Chekhov, of course, refused. Chekhov got, later on, he was selected for academy, he was an academician. We'll get later to that. So, important moment here is that Nemirovich Danchenko understood the value of Siegel and value of Chekhov. He was a very intelligent person. He read all his life. He was writing plays by himself. His mother was a very intelligent woman, and she just, I don't know, she took very serious charge in education Nemirovich Danchenko. This man, who we know, like famous Stanislavski, who created method of Stanislavski based on Chekhov plays. So he didn't like Chekhov in the beginning. He hated Siegel. Not because, yeah, Chekhov changed his life. He was, Stanislavski was a playboy. He didn't graduate high school. He didn't read too much. The most important part of, because he was rich, and in Russian tradition, rich people try to educate their children in the theater. It was a tradition. It started from surf theater, and then it was like, it started developing more and more like home theater. So Stanislavski came from home theater. He was very successful, very handsome, very just beautiful mustache.
I don't know.
Young,
picture yeah, of young Stanislavski. I don't know if he's handsome.
Before he was, this is very influenced by Chekhov, yeah.
Yes, young, handsome Stanislavski.
Yeah,
yeah.
It was a talented person. There was not too much education. He didn't read too much, except what was. He read Shakespeare, of course. He read, and they tried to do Shakespeare all the time. So, but he was not. He missed Chekhov. He didn't understand. He said, he was disgusted by Siegel. So it is what, yeah, there's no plot. What to do, you don't know what to do with it. So, and because, but it is interesting, let's mention it, because Stanislavski was a different man. So in the Chariotchet, it is a character, Petr Trofimov. Chekhov wrote it from his son, out of wedlock, son with maid, that his mother forced her to to have a relationship with Nislavsky because he was depressed. So he had a son. I could refer you to the book. It is a book in Russian, unfortunately, only. Aleksey, she was a director of Moscow Art Theater, and it is a book of Stanislavsky, Imirovich Dachenko, Chekhov and others. So his name is Shilov, and I think Shilov, or maybe Shilovsky, sorry. But in that book you can see exactly, you can see the face who was prototype for Peter Trofimov. So when Stanislavsky was young, so before he got married, before he organized Moscow Art Theater, he was a fan of the Carda Ballet. So if he liked a girl in the Carda Ballet, he sent her flower. And if she put the flower in her dress while she's dancing, whatever she's dancing, so it means that they go into the dinner after that. If she's not putting flower, it means they're not going to. It was many of them who Stanislavski tried to just to convince to go to have a dinner and etc. etc. So he was because of his birth, because he was very rich. His father was mayor, not his uncle was mayor of the Moscow, who was killed because of scandalous love affair. The person who didn't like that what he did to his wife came in and shot him into an intimate place. It was a scandal. So they didn't show the corpse because it was a scandal. So, after that, Chekhov wrote a famous note: "If your wife wasn't unfaithful to you, rejoice and be happy. She was unfaithful to you, not to your motherland." So it was contradiction of the time. So people, hypocrisy was everywhere, and Stanislavski was part of that. So, as I said, if not Nemirovich Danchenko, Siegel would be missed. And Nemirovich Danchenko started doing rehearsals with his school, and he was coaching actors. Stanislavski was sending blocking mise-en-scene from outside. He was writing it in his country estate, and he was sending by letters. So he was drawing mise-en-scene. He joined rehearsals on the last stage of. So, and when success happened, everybody was very surprised because they didn't expect it. Maybe except Nemirovich. So why I mention Nemirovich? Because when I was a student, I read his rehearsals they published of Three Sisters. It's very interesting, very interesting. It's a revelation for that time, I believe. You can find YouTube production which says directed by Nemirovich Danchenko. Of course, it's not that. It's Moscow Art Theater, and it is blackened by Nemirovich Danchenko, but the spirit is gone. So in Chekhov, it's very important to have a spirit. Because whatever characters are saying is not true. They're lying. Intentionally. They're all lying because they don't want to hurt each other. For example, Siegel, yeah? What's a comedy? What's comedy about? What's comical about that? Comedy coming through accident, because people try to do good things and instead of doing good things, they do bad things without desire. They just want to do good things. And you can see that if you follow how Chekhov structured that, everything happened by accident. Like, for example, in the Siegel, everybody comes because Soaring is dying. From cancer. What kind of cancer, Chekhov doesn't clarify, but probably it was lung cancer. How I could prove it? Treplev says in the fourth act, my mother came, we sent her a telegram about Soaring condition. This time, it's real. So it means the first telegram was sent before, before Curtin, yeah? So, of course, initial event, how Stanislavski, who was a genius, yeah? And I would say Chekhov, after success of Siegel, Stanislavski was a different man. Whatever Chekhov, he read everything what Chekhov wrote. Chekhov became like board of directors. Chekhov started become the most like the general advisor, the head of advisory board, you would say these days. And of course, Chekhov introduced Moscow theater to Mitterling, to Knut Gamsen. They miss symbolism, and symbolism was very much part of the time. So even he was Chekhov making fun of Mir iskustva, like world of art. He was, he called them like naughty boys. Still, symbolism it's a powerful movement, and Treplev represented symbolism. You cannot just ignore it. So, Stanislavski, by exploring Chekhov, he found unique structures that help directors. So Chekhov without director cannot be done. It is there is no plot. So director has to find a plot, which invisible, yeah. But it has to be. I would say plot is a message, yeah. Why to do particular play today? So this is. Without that, Chekhov would be melancholic, depression, and everybody would be whining of the whole play. If no Stein, so everybody will leave. What we have enough whining in our real life. Yeah. So Stanislavski created a method, which is. Because of the circumstances of the time was not very well translated into English, and sometimes into Russian as well, but into English definitely, because whatever is translated into English, it has nothing to do with Stanislavski discovered. Whatever Lee Strasberg get from Stanislavski, even Stella Adler, it is a post Stanislavski. Stanislavski who's still looking for something, for meaning. And the most beautiful idea he found that that play is the spine of events. So not whatever people saying to each other, yeah? What people were doing to each other. So events, this is whatever we need to, we can trust to. So whatever is happening, like a fact. So in from that, he found, I don't know how he did it, because you can see it's in North Theater the same. It's also like, there's three stages. So he found initial event, central event, and main event. And this is his most beautiful discovery he did. And in American, nobody talks about that. In Russia, it's not in the books. It's. I got it from my teacher, who got from a teacher, and she got from Stanislavski. It is from hand to hand. Then I start seeing in Vasiliev books, in Kamaginka's book, definition, Dostanogov. It is Russian, like beautiful, wonderful directors who just explain Stanislavski to future generations. And So, initial event, it is something that happens before curtains, what triggers action. So, and it affects every character in the play. Central event, it is a drastic change of plot. Drastic, yeah? Even you can see nothing happened in Chekhov, but still plot exists. Yeah? And drastic change of plot, it is a central event. And main event is the most emotional event. It's a beautiful idea, beautiful. So now you have two. You can do, you can apply not only Chekhov, you can apply to every play. Even to, yeah, and one of teachers, I remember, they taught us how to find structure in Hamlet. And we will, like most of us right now in our class, very famous directors, but we will like going around like two weeks, we couldn't find it. And we were just crying, we couldn't find it. What initial event of Hamlet? And she said, funeral of the father. That is double event. Funeral of the father, marriage of his mother. This is, everybody comes to the funeral, and everybody found himself in a wedding. This is beautiful. Everybody, except 14 brothers, of course. 14 brothers comes in the end. So immediately, central event is mousetrap, reaction of Claudius, immediately, boom. And then we can talk about that. This main event is, it's about what you want to say. Yeah, definitely it's because Hamlet is a, it is a play about conflict these times. So it is about Hamlet death. I saw Bergman production, maybe some of you have seen it. Hamlet, he did it, 14 brass came. It was his was main event. But 14 brass came and with automatic weapons started shooting the audience. So it was very strong, actually. So Stanislavski changed after meeting Chekhov. It was only beginning of Stanislavski because Siegel was the beginning, and Siegel is structured as a cascade, a chain of accident. If initial event of the play, it is a opening night of Treble play, and everybody comes, yeah. But you can see how many relationships are there, yeah. Masha bringing Medvedenko because she wants Treplev to be jealous. Yeah, she doesn't care about Medvedenko. Then Polina is in a relationship with Dorn, and Polina is married to Shamraev. Dorn has a relationship with Arkadin in the past. You see how many who bring Trigorin. So it is kind of some kind of intertwine of so many difficult conflicting relationship. Flop the play, not because, and now they all know that Sorin is dying, but they cannot tell him he's dying, because in Russian tradition, you cannot tell a person by that time. Even in my time, you cannot tell people if they're seriously ill. Maybe it was changed maybe the last 20, 25 years. Before that, it was not in Russian tradition. You cannot tell people, it's unethical, it was, yeah. To tell people that they're in trouble. So, but it is a many, many certain kind of hidden things without being Russian, you probably will find yourself in trouble. First of all, Arkadina is not coming for vacation, as she said, yeah? She's coming because Sorin is dying. In Russian tradition also, if you marry low class, you lose your right for inheritance. She married Treplev's father, and she's not inherited, so she's out. She's not allowed to own. So the only thing she could, the only thing Treplev could, after Sorin's death, could have a chance to inherit that estate, but it has to be legally happened a legal way. So she lost inheritance to the state. And what happened, the most difficult part is here, she made Treplev very vulnerable to the mandatory military service. In Russia, everybody except aristocrats has to go to serve into the army. Yeah, so Treplev is not aristocrat because she married an actor who was not aristocrat. So Treplev is, I would say, bastard, I don't know, something like, he has no aristocracy. So the only way to get aristocracy back, you need to go to university and you can get savory and you will get aristocracy status. So like Chekhov did, small aristocracy status. And but what happened, so Treplev left university. By that time it was 30,000 rubles. And he asking for more. There's a conflict, you see, between Arkadina and Treplev about money. So it is a lot going on when play gets moving, and they start using some sense. And Arkadina, she sense, and she concerned about Sorin, who has lung disease. And of course, it's nobody wants to stop Chekhov play. It happens by itself. It's Treplev's play. It happens by itself. So, and he see everybody is talking. He just losing temper and stop the play, insulting Nina by that. So, and the conflict start growing forward. Okay. No. So no. Let's talk about a little bit about how Chekhov was writing his play. Chekhov's world is multi-populated. It's very, very. It's more than 10,000 characters in his world. So the way he wrote it, he was some kind of submergent from life. He had problems with people by the time, like famous Grace Hooper. He used Levitan in one of his lovers or students, Kovshinnikova. So we don't have these pictures, no? But we have Levitan, yeah. So, after this story was published, Levitan didn't talk to Chekhov for 3 years. Kovshinnikova didn't talk to Chekhov for 3 years. Levitan challenged him for the duel. So, he was using real people to write. To write fiction and to write plays. Because I started working, especially when I immigrated here, on Chekhov a lot, so I find out that every character in his play has sometimes few short stories that was preparation for the character. So it's imperative to, if you want to do the play, you need to reach your story. Otherwise, you will miss essence of what it is about. So, Lika Mizinova, yeah? Do we have her? Mm-hmm. She's a very interesting character because she was friend of Maria Palna. Maria Paulina Chekhov. It recently was made a movie, French movie, about relationship between Chekhov and Lika Mizinova. Maybe it is historically it's true, but the way it's done, it's very vulgar. Definitely they had relationship because when she came to Chekhov through his sister, and mostly she was interested in Chekhov. So she was pursuing him. He somehow reacted on that, but I don't know what really happened. But when she was trying to make affair with Levitan, Chekhov won't commit suicide. It means something was happening there. So if nothing was happening, why he wanted to commit suicide? So definitely it was a friend of Chekhov. His name was Potapenko, who was a very famous writer and very charming man, and he was an opera singer himself. He was married, but he liked Lika Mizinova too. But I don't know, Lika Mizinova, her objective of her life was to get Chekhov. So she's trying to make him jealous, meeting a different man. Strange mentality, but what you can do. Definitely something was going on between them, and she became prototype for Nina Zarechina. Not only her, of course, it is another character, Lydia Vilova. Yeah, we don't have her. Vilova, no? Okay, no, it doesn't matter. It is so. Chekhov. This is Maria Savina. Maria Savina was a prototype for Arkadina. So it is. If you start exploring Chekhov, you see real faces. You see real stories that could inspire you to create a character. Because huge misunderstanding that Stanislavski created in the world of the theater, me and given circumstances. It is it's not true. Given circumstances, it's imaginative circumstances, it's already not you. You in your given circumstances, it's you. You in somebody else's circumstances, it's a character. So if you want to get the character, so you have to go in the direction to build the character. So it is a lot of material to find that person's life, to express that person's life through your whatever instrument you have. So without exploring Chekhov world, you will fail, because experience is not enough to create what Chekhov meant. What is Commissar Zhevsky? Yeah. Of course, Chekhov like what she did in a signal, but nobody knows what she did. So what we know that Lika Mizinova and Avilova were prototypes for that character. And Vavilova remembers, I don't know if it's true or not true, but it helped me to create a fantasy about that. Vavilova said when they met in 1895, the year he wrote Seagull, they met in a masquerade ball of Suvorin. There was a publisher who helped Chekhov. He pushed Chekhov, and they were friends for a long, long time until Dreyfus case. So when Suvorin proved strong case of anti-Semitism. But before that they were friends. So and Avilova came when she was a young woman. She was married with two children. She came to Masquerade Ball under the mask. They met with Chekhov and they talked all evening, and she gave him medallion. And it says Chekhov, and medallion open, read line to page 281, lines 82. And it's in that, and when Chekhov, and she meant that that phrase that Chekhov used, if you need my life, come and take it. So, but when, and he invited for the opening night for Seagal, and she came, and she felt like everybody looking at it, at her. And then, when it came to that scene, she realized it is a different number. So it's page 12, or 21, and line 12. She ran back home and opened a book and found that it's not good for young women go to masquerade. It's a lot going on there between. So he. And when you find out that kind of stuff, you start digging in and say, what's going on? What are they doing there? So, you know, for example, Three Sisters, question about Potapov and Natasha. And we know. Right now it's opening truth about Chekhov, which was not just easy man. Because we know that it is icon, yeah? Most of the, in Russian time, Soviet time, it was an icon, the man who never had a sex in his life. He was just, yeah, the most pure human being, angel. And we know that he wrote in one of the, his diaries, I lost virginity when I was 14. Because when parents left him, he was alone, and next to their house was a whorehouse. And it's Claudia Ivanovna, Tita Klasha, uncle, she was head of that house, so she killed. But Maria Palna crossed it out with ink, so it took like few generation of scientists to take it out. So then, in Three Sisters, when he said to write Three Sisters, and he was writing that based on the cast of Moscow Theater, his wife, Knipper Chekhov, got a miscarriage. Chekhov ran to Moscow from Crimea, where he was, and find out that his carriage is 6 weeks old, and they have a relationship 4 weeks before that. So, could you imagine Chekhov, I don't know, but he's still writing Three Sisters. What? So it means that every character has Chekhov fate. Definitely, we know now that Knipper Chekhov was a lover of Nemirovich Danchenko before Chekhov got married to her. Nemirovich Danchenko was married happily, and he never divorced his wife, but she was, they have a relationship for a long time, so Chekhov knew about it. So they, but he was very attractive to that woman, and it was sadly to know they married Chekhov and this woman because they wanted to have their own playwright. So they have him. So every play he wrote after that was for Moscow at the end. So it was, how to say so, I would say in Chekhov play everything deeply connected to his life, deeply. He wrote Three Sisters in a house he bought for her in the Crimea on the Black Sea shore, and it is just you can see waves coming to the foundation of the house, and. What state of mind Chekhov was at that time? He created a character to Zinbach, which is if you translate it from German, it is thousands of springs. And Salione was coming from the sea. So whatever happens to what was happening in his head and his heart by the time affected the work he did. And if you just pay attention to the lines only, which is coded, they coded somehow, you will never find what's going on in reality. So Chekhov coded his lines. In our job to find out what he meant by that. Okay, so okay, no, let's touch structure of Chekhov plays. No, the most famous play and I believe the best play he wrote is Uncle Vanya. But he wrote it many times, yeah, Platona. It was the first version of when he wrote Platon when he was 18 years old. He gave it to Ermolova, a very famous Russian actress. It is a portrait of her by Serov. You can Google find it. It is a, she was famously good. So, but she never read the play. So. Now you can see this play, version of this play. Kate Blanchett is doing on Broadway, yeah? But the best adaptation of that play, it is a film version of Nikita Mikhalkov. It is an unfinished piece for mechanical piano and how else?
Player piano.
Or player piano. Of course, it's not pure Platonov. It is an adaptation of Platonov with insertion from different short stories. I think it's best interpretation of Chekhov, you can see in the film frame. I recommend everybody to look at that because the tone of the Chekhov is there. Ironical, full of despair and sense of humor at the same time. So, as I said, Chekhov, how he wrote his plays or fiction, we don't know. But from it is known that from 1882 to 1889 he was obsessed with Saint George myth. What does mean St. George in Russian culture? This image was an herb of Romanov's family. This the most famous icon in Russian culture. Before revolution, every house has to have an icon, and 75% variation of that. So it is the most powerful myth of Russian culture, which is St. George killing dragon to save virgin. It is a different variation, but it is a triangle, yeah? Triangle, virgin, hero, and dragon. Yeah. And Uncle Vanya is a variation of that myth. It's based on triangles, comical, real, unreal. So Uncle Vanya sometimes think he's a St. George, real St. George, in Serebrikov think he's St. George, and Astrov think he's St. George. And in play structured by triangles. Wood Demon also was written before that. It's also the same variation of the same story. So so Chekhov's mythology, I would say, attention to it. You can see he doesn't reveal it. Yeah, he doesn't. You don't know. It's you need to explore material to find out that is there. It is an interesting work of one of two scientists of Chekhov. His name is the name of the book Chekhov from Eye to Eye, Chekhov's Glass on a Glass, and he explored Chekhov. Chekhov variation in connection to the St. George myth. I use it when I directed that piece, and it helped me a lot because it creates some kind of depth. It creates a depth relationship. It creates depth of meaning because. Somewhere in the notes, Chekhov wrote that I sometimes lose faith in my work because I believe I have to tell people what life is about, something like that. So, and it is when I start doing Uncle Vanya, and I thought, why to do it? So, and I find out I was exploring the subject, and the meaning of the play came as a nobody is guilty for your problem. Nobody's fault if something wrong with you. It is nobody to blame except yourself. Because, you can see Uncle Vanya looking for him to blame and find nobody to blame. Serebrikov. And it's this beautiful, idea. It's just some kind of idea of reconciliation with the world around you. So every play he wrote, it is a serious work of many layers, and definitely every play has a hidden ritual. To illustrate it, I would love to show you some maybe. Piece of the George's thriller, production of Cheriot, and let's take a look a little bit. You don't need to look like 40 minutes.
Disgrazia!
Mi pare che siano più.
Sì, sono loro. Oddio, come mi sento!
Sono proprio loro, andiamo all'incontro, eh? Magari sai, neanche mi riconosce. Sono 5 anni che non lo vedo.
Oddio, come mi sento!
It is before Raniewski comes. It's opening, it's a beginning. Production was done in 1972, and it was, and since then it changed.
It's gone to their country.
impression of Chekhov. After that, Chekhov became cliché. Chekhov and why?
La bianca e la viola sono rimaste tali e quali le ha lasciate. Ma la più bella di tutte è questa.
The most powerful part of that.
Dormivo qui quando ero bambina. Ma anche adesso mi sento una bambina.
George Strelitz is very stylish. He's stylish. He likes style. He's very. You see the beautiful ceiling over there that moves, and it is. It's become iconic.
Il mio. Oh, come.
It's obviously, it's not like farce, yeah, it's not farce, but it, you can see it is a lot, it's light, it is a, you can see in relationship it is a hope, it is a enlightenment, they're not depressed, they're having a good time, actually. Even if Cherry Orchard should be sold, but nobody plays it, it's a disaster. This play is available on YouTube, you can take a look at that. It's 4 hours long, we don't need to look at it all for 4 hours. Yeah? But what we can pause it, yeah. So it was serious approach to Siegel, and he found ritual behind, and ritual was mourning. That's obvious, yeah. Because Cherry Orchard gets sold, so and mourning was basically like ancient Greek mourners, yeah, it was a basic ritual for George Strelitz ideas. And it's very touching, and it's very powerful, and so it's important to find ritual in Chekhov's will, because he meant, so, for example, three sisters, yeah? Three sisters, you can see that he builds time by church calendar. So it's first named the first act. It's named of Irina by Russian tradition. You cannot name people as you wish. Yeah, you have to take it from calendar of the church and choose from the calendar. So. Carnival people. It is a Muslims. Yeah, it is a big celebration before great fasting, and leads to Easter. So, and three sisters. It is a reference to Trinity of Russian, the most famous Russian icon. Of the Trinity. It's very, very, very religious aspect of that. So very often, like tea time become powerful ritual to hang yourself or to drink a tea. Like Uncle Vanya, most of the stuff happens around the table when people drink tea. And he wrote somewhere, Chekhov wrote somewhere, that I want to build, to do the place when people drink tea and nothing is happening, but through that kind of ritual, happening, how to say, happening, they live through through global misfortunes. So it was intentional that in Chekhov plays he didn't want he didn't want too much action like we used to have. Even the most interesting things, the most active things in Chekhov plays happen between the acts, behind the stage. So nothing is happening on our eyes. It is happening. It's happening in between acts, or it happening without us seeing that. Even Uncle Vanya, he's trying to kill Serebrikov and he misses. So the death is not happening. It become comical effect. So. Okay, so so much to say. Maybe we can try. Maybe if you have any questions, maybe I'll try to start from there.
So, time call for questions and answers.
Bit secondary question, but why is St. George became such a central icon in Russia? After all, it took place in Syria, which is today's Lebanon. The event, St. George, it became, why did it become such a central, got a central attention in the Russian culture?
No, it's happened before Chekhov was born.
Oh, of course, there's no question about this. But therefore, I said it's a secondary question. But it is a central icon in Russia.
It happened historically. It happened historically. Because Russia was under Mongolo-Tatar yoke for so many years, for 400 years, and it was. Russia was got independence only start getting independence like lately, like in the 14th century. So it, I don't know. It is a very interesting question, but I don't know how to refer to Chekhov world. The only referral I have like Chekhov user myth to structure his work, fiction and plays, about the importance of myth. I don't know, but why Madonna in the Child, which is very powerful, iconic image in Russia, in the times of Mongol-Tatar intervention, which was very destructive to Russia. People tried to defend their villages as a broad icon and it stopped intervention. So
I understand. This is the universal event, the Madonna and the Child, the Troitsa. But this is such a regional event outside of Russia, becomes a central one thereafter in the Russian culture. And explaining even Chekhov, any triangle relationship will explain the triangle relationship in Chekhov's plays. Mm-hmm. Why particular that one?
No, it is not. It's only I would say he was obsessed with it only for 8 years. He was experimenting with that. It's not because every powerful tradition goes to the myth, which is very interesting subject for us. Like if we do theater, myth probably is the most powerful source of energy you can ever find because it survived times. So, and Stanislavski found the method to work on Chekhov plays and later on other plays. He found the theory of archetype, which links to the myth. So, archetype that is mythological character that survived times, and then you can connect to the energy to build your character, which is I don't know. These days, many theater movements go in that direction, direction of the myth, which Chekhov used for his writing. Which I found fascinating because it is a depth. Myth is a depth of the relationship. It was actually Chekhov brought that book to life he was the one who introduced Stanislavski. To 36 dramatic situation by Carlo Gozzi. Carlo Gozzi wrote a book that he classified every situation you can write you don't create anything new. You repeat 36. Before that it was Schiller who found only 12. And many people believe that 12 dramatic situation is enough to cover everything what is written. Then Carlo Gozzi wrote a book about 36, and it's published. It's published in English too by Carlo Gozzi. So, but Chekhov introduced Stanislavski to that book. So, and it explained his method in the most powerful way because. These days, probably Stanislavski method is the most powerful, is the most helpful method to build a theater. I would say like deep theater, like this one, theater of meaning, theater of vibration, to talk to people today, not just entertain people. Try to shape ideas about life. Because Chekhov said human destiny is to find meaning of your life. If you don't find meaning of your life, you live in a waste. This is what the whole Chekhov is about. He's trying to inspire you with your own personal meaning, in one of his notebooks, he wrote, "It is a personal responsibility of every human being to find its own God. Nobody is responsible for that except you. So nobody will give you God except you yourself." It's Chekhov wrote. It's very inspiring. Very beautiful. So this is, and I would say, no matter what this myth is about, I'm not a big fan of actually. It looks like very alien to me. It's not Russian, you're right, it's not Russian.
That was my question.
It's not Russian, but it became Russian because Russia in the Chekhov time, apart from Chekhov, believed, and it was, big movement about aristocracy, that Russia will become a third Rome. and it will be resurrection of faith in Russia. So this is what Putin is after right now, these days, to build Russia as a pilgrimage, future pilgrimage for spiritual resurrection of human race. So, but it was so utopical that Chekhov was making fun of that, because it is, he wrote about that, nobody, I don't understand what I'm writing, because people who praise me, they don't see my point. People who hate me, they think I'm writing trifles, but people who like me, they don't see my point. And the point is, it is about essential meaning of life. So, and in his attention to the myth, it's fascinating, because the meaning of life is people were looking from ancient Greece, but it was interesting director from Greece. He said even Chekhov inherited Greek mythology. You cannot perform Chekhov in the Greek theater. It's ridiculous, because it became art form for home theater. It is ridiculous to put samovar in a desk in the amphitheater of Greece. You cannot perform Chekhov, Stanislavski, discovered. It has, but it is a contradiction of the Chekhov role. It's based on myth, but it's not a myth. It makes our life more, more tensive towards to the meaning. And every time we touch Chekhov, we got inspired. What our life is about. This is what discovery I found by working with Chekhov. Every time I touch Chekhov, my life become uplifted. Something about my life become important for myself, even.
Important or meaningful?
It's a very good question. Both, I would say, and meaningful and important, because Chekhov touches fundamental ideas what is important in life. He wrote somewhere, I was never interested to write for money. Not because it was not inspiring for me to write for money. I never had money in my life, maybe because of that. When he was close to his death, it was he needed to buy that property in Crimea, and he needed money, so he sold his past and future production to the publisher. His name was Marx. It has nothing to do with Karl Marx, who was the father of Russian Revolution. But he bought it from him, and so the Chekhov got like 10,000 or 40,000 rubles, and then everything he wrote for free. So the only money he got from the theater, because it wasn't his fiction was the most popular the most demanding on the market of fiction. So,
the beginning film was almost like a vaudeville, almost like Marx Brothers.
Yeah.
Is any Chekhov performed that vaudevillian style, that
outrageous comedy style?
No, no, no. I brought Jacques Tati because Jacques Tati, for me, like very much in a tune with Chekhov. Even you can see the slapstick. Chekhov is not slapstick. But the atmosphere of Jacques Tati films very Chekhovian. I don't know, I would say Lady with the Love Dog very much, the beginning of Lady with the Love Dog very much match Miss Chekhov's Holiday. And the music, it could be easily happen in Yalta,
yeah.
in when Gurov meet Anna Sergeyevna, and then they go through the kind of the biggest love of their life. But it is a, yeah, it is a contradiction and paradox of Chekhov. It starts, it's always has an arch somewhere, and it is in global questions, because Gurov, for example, who had millions of love affairs, finally fall in love with a very ordinary woman and it changed his life. In her life as well, that they were infected by love, which is nobody could be guaranteed from that, and it is so human. And Chekhov just make a transition of the person by very human affection. I don't know, like Three Sisters, for example. I see that Andrei is just portrayed as a very mediocre, provincial, boring person. But it's not what Chekhov wrote. He wrote he's a pride of the family. He's I don't know, and Stein was playing violin, yeah? And he was a good violin player. So, and then if Andrei is playing like, what the story is about? He has to play good. it is a story about, like Macbeth, yeah? It's a story about how beautiful man was destroyed by witches. Who is witches? We can say in Iraq war it was, we can say witches were bush and chimney, but yeah, you find whose witches are in the story of Macbeth become contemporary. The same is with Andrei. He's a great man and pride of the family, provincial life, that love affair with that girl just destroyed him completely. And nobody's fault. It's nobody's fault. Like today I tried to, and it affected our meeting today. I was planning to come in time, and suddenly train never stopped. They stopped. Six train never stopped. It always running. What was that? I think what's the meaning of that? Why you cannot come in time to this important meeting? They plan many months in advance. We were thinking about it, preparing for it. So life. The entropy of life in Chekhov world, it is just have a mystical meaning very often.
So, can you talk about Three Sisters and Swan Song now? What moves you to do these plays now?
I want to do Three Sisters because. Because of very unhappy life we live through right now. That election that took place unexpectedly. That kind of unfairness of what obviously is happening on the big screens everywhere. It is that it's about an intelligent person. Is suffering. It is what is allowed to Trump, not allowed to anybody else, yeah? It is what it is allowed to people with status. It's suddenly, it is, it, I see a lot of corruption of ideas, corruption of life. And in Three Sisters, I see like intelligent people come together, try to make each other to feel good about each other. That it is a, it's, it is a time, this time will pass, and we will be happy. we will be in need. We will be in need because it was Chekhovian theme. I want to be needed. But I don't know what. I think I'm best in talking about meaning of life. He said it in his one of his notebooks. But I would say, yeah, for me, as Richard, I want to give myself and people around me hope that this difficult time will pass, and hopefully more like people like us will. Or Three Sisters, like Three Sisters, will change majority of people who live around us, you know, in America. Will be not 60, will be like 80%. Because Vyshinin says about it, today only three of you, in 200 years it would be like several million. So and life would be different. You don't, it is less the less chance you will choose wrong woman, because most of them will be like Three Sisters who you don't need to marry, and then like Andrei did, and then to like Chekhov did. Somebody asked him, why, what you wouldn't do if you start life again? He said, I would never get married. So there's a, how many many of us we go in the wrong relationship and suffer from that. When it's about life, it's about partnership. How Three Sisters, I think, promote partnership on any level. So you like, you get like. No, it is not one way, like Natasha. Which she's not, it's not her fault. She's a charming woman. The life, entropy of life is stronger than our intentions. And because of that, I believe we need to create much more sensitive environment for people we love. There's more sensitivity and more rules we all have to follow. Not just one person here decided, yeah, I could talk, lock a talk, and I will be president. No, it is whatever happens in political life very much pushed me to that kind of direction, because the unfairness of what happened around us and
unpunishability, like invincibility.
So I would believe, because we were playing to the seagull, and I thought the seagull would be ridiculous effort, because seagull is about need. I want to be needed as an artist. The whole play is about it, as I hear that. And three Sisters, I would believe. When I read that story about Chekhov, who survived his betrayal of his wife, it was a play about hope. It's very personal. Kuligin is also Chekhov. Vyshinin is Chekhov. Every character in his play, especially in Three Sisters, is Chekhov. Even Natasha. Who he hates somewhere. Svensson, I would say, I work with this Russian actress, a very beautiful Russian actress, I decided I don't want to do plays in Russian because I don't see audience for the theater I'm interested in. If you're an intelligent person, you speak English. If you don't you're not an intelligent person, why have to do it? But this, the sectors, when they perform in English, they're bad. But when they do it in Russian, they're very good. So, and I would believe Svensson is a play is about theater. It is a declaration of love to the theater, Svensson, even a short one. Because Chekhov loved theater, he was sneaking in the theater since he was a child. He just was attracted to the atmosphere of the theater. Even he tried to change nature of the theater, which is imperative. And I believe American Broadway theater is still theater that Chekhov hated, because it is Chekhov was for ensemble theater, and Nemirovich, Dachenko trained his actors to be ensemble. So, and Dmitry Chekhov remembers that when we got that success with Siegel, we were shocked because we had love for our theater, for Chekhov, and for each other. And this kind of love somehow affected everybody in the audience. And people start, people start getting in lines because it was winter. And it was like people staying nights at night to get tickets for the miraculous happening. And it was, they never had success that much after that. Three Sisters, like Chekhov remembers. Curtain call was 12 times after first act. So it was 3 times after second. It was no curtain calls after third. It was like one call after fourth. So it was cold reception of Three Sisters. It started getting more bigger after. They start playing and understanding what's going on. Because Chekhov hated Stanislavski. He said, he doesn't understand me. Although what happened by that time, I don't know, because only in the books, everything in the books, we don't know. Theater, whatever, these days why theater exists and what theater is about, I believe it's about vibration. If we get to right vibration with the audience, yeah, we are there. But how we can miss it? I believe Three Sisters has whatever we are working right now on, and try to find hope and life and sense of humor. I believe, but I could make a mistake. I believe it is a vibration of hope, which we need right now. Look, see. Outside, go outside. Everybody goes against Trump almost every week. I don't know, something like I love Stephen Colbert to watch every night, because and everybody's watching Stephen Colbert. Nobody watched James Fallon. Everybody, and he wants to go political now too. But it's not about politics. It's about what our life is about right now. It's about what's going to happen to us. We're going to war. We're not going to war, but how are we going to represent ourselves in the world, in ourselves, what we are, what our life is about, what is our pride, what is our idea of life, what we're after, because theater is very domestic culture. It's not. It's not international. I believe it's very domestic, because it's a vibration on us to the people who live around us.
You're saying it about in New York, in Manhattan, about plays that were written over 100 years ago. So it's not that local as such, but a different way. So would you say that Chekhov, had he lived in our days, would write kind of a Woody Allen's.
Wow. No, Woody Allen is different.
Of course, different, but I'm asking, would Chekhov dwell in the same direction for the human essence?
Well, first of all, Woody Allen, it is it's very, very New York, yeah, and very ironical, and it is laughing at yourself, because that is the meaning of that kind of don't take yourself seriously, how I see that. But Chekhov, deeper than that. Chekhov is about not only privileged people who live in Manhattan, it's about all of us, no matter where we're from, what language you speak. It's about...
So it is universal, because it's more localized. It cannot be.
No,
play cannot.
I would say, it's my opinion, of course. Yeah, Chekhov, open to interpretations, and it is... thank you. So any person could interpret Chekhov differently. So, and it's beauty of Chekhov, who could have meaning for people who live in Africa and here. I'm just talking about why I'm doing Chekhov here today in New York, not because he looks like Woody Allen. Because for me, I see hope and light in that plane, in that particular plane, and I want to share it with people who come and give it a hand of light and uplift. This is, yeah. Sorry that it was a little bit. First of all, it was late. So, sorry, it was. Because of